Worship with us this morning here at Abundant Life.
Is it true that you are? turned into wine. You opened the eyes of the blind. There's no one like you, not like you. Into the darkness you shine, and out of the ashes we rise. There's no
sings. What a beautiful day to worship the Lord. I was thinking when they first started singing, I was thinking, isn't it an awesome thought to think that God, who has billions of people to deal with, and you're on His mind. He's mindful of you. I don't know how many times I've heard that song and loved that song, but boy, just a while ago, it just kind of dawned on me, just in all of the people around the globe, He's thinking about us. Boy, what a great Father that you and I have. This is awesome. I'm ready to worship God. I want God to do something incredible today. I really do. I want you, if you will, I want you to grab your Bibles. I want to turn me to 2 Kings chapter 6. 2 Kings chapter 6. As you're turning there, let me just say this to our Abundant Life family. I just want to say thank you for your faithfulness. I've read articles that during this church shutdown time, where a lot of churches have suffered financially. I just want to say to you, thank you so much for keeping Abundant Life healthy. You have been so faithful in your prayers and in your giving, and I just want to take a moment and just say thank you for your faithfulness in what we're doing here. I want to talk to you for a few minutes this morning on this subject. The odds are in your favor when God is in your corner. Now, I want that to kind of settle in for a moment. The odds are always in your favor when God is in your corner. And here's the good part. If you're a child of God, there's never a moment, there's never a day that goes by that He's not in your corner. He's with you. Now, there's times that we don't feel Him. There's times that He seems distant to us, but yet He is always with us. So we're gonna look at this story, and going to be a familiar story to some of us, but maybe we're going to just take it from a different viewpoint this morning and look and see what God has got in store for us. 2 Kings chapter 6, we're going to start reading with verse 8 down through 13. Now, when we get done reading our text, I want you just to keep your Bible open, because throughout this message this morning, I'm going to be reading more scripture and followed in chapter 6, so you'll be able to stay with me there. Starting with verse 8, the Bible said this: Now the king of Syria was making war against Israel, and he consulted with his servant, saying, My camp shall be in such and such a place. And the man of God sent to the king of Israel, saying, Beware that you do not pass this place, for the Syrians are coming down there. Then the king of Israel sent someone to the place of which the man of God had told him. Thus he warned him, and he was watchful there, not just once or twice. Therefore the heart of the king of Syria was greatly troubled by this thing, and he called his servants, and he said to them, Will you not show me which of us is for the king of Israel? Verse 12 said, And one of his servants said, None, my lord, O king, but Elijah the prophet, who is in Israel, tells the king of Israel the words that you speak in your bedroom. So he said, Go and see where he is, that I may send and get him. And it was told him, saying, Surely he's in Dothan. Can I tell you, the odds are always in our favor when God is in our corner. Let me pray for you. Father, in the name of Jesus, as we come this morning, we just pray for your anointing. We pray for your touch to be upon this service today, God. We pray for those that would be watching, but God, I pray that they just not be watching. I pray that the Holy Spirit would begin to deal with their hearts today, God. I pray, God, that faith would rise up in areas, God. I pray for your touch to be fresh upon them, God. Father, even this season that we can't come together and worship, God, we've got to be separated, but God, I know that there is no distance in you. So Father, I pray that in that living room or in that office or wherever they may be, I pray that the anointing and the presence of a holy God would just saturate that place where they're at. I pray, God, for your touch to be fresh upon us today. God, take and anoint this vessel of clay one more time. God, that you would anoint it and use it, God, that your word would go forth, accomplish what it's sent out to do. And God, that we would give you praise, we would give you honor, and we would give you all the glory In Jesus' name we pray. And everybody said amen. Amen. The odds are always in your favor when God is in your corner. Then the story that we read about Elijah being surrounded, most of us will know this story or at least somewhat familiar with it. But I want us to look at some things here. The prophet of God, he begins to reveal the plans of the enemy. Now I want you to get a hold of this, that the prophet of God is in such tune with God that he can hear the plans that the enemy is making against him. And I think that you and I need to have a relationship with God that when the enemy is trying to make plans to destroy, to attack us, we need to be able to hear the voice of God and to know the plans, because this is what the prophet of God was doing. He was revealing the plans of what the enemy was trying to do. Nothing catches God by surprise, and we need to understand that. But unfortunately, we too often fail to hear God's voice because we are too focused on the enemy's schemes. We are so focused on what he's doing and how he's doing it and the results that he's getting that we forget to hear what God is doing. So all of a sudden, instead of hearing the voice of God, we're looking at all the schemes that are going on and we're looking at what the devil is doing. I think the greatest plan that the church can have is this. I need to hear the voice of God. I need to hear what God's direction is, not man's direction. Listen, we've always been in a fight with the devil. We've always been an adversary ever since we were a child of God. So we need to understand, I got to quit looking at the schemes that the enemy's doing and start saying, God, give me an ear that I can hear what you're saying to me. What do I need to do, God? So we begin to look at this story, and the story goes something like this. The servant saw the circumstances. Now, the servant is not the prophet. The servant is someone who's working with the prophet. But the servant, he sees the circumstances. So if you will, look at verse 14 and 15. And the Bible said this, therefore, he sent horses and chariots and a great army there. And they came by night and they surrounded the city. And when the servant of the man of God arose early and went out, there was an army surrounding the city with horses and chariots. And his servant said, alas, my master, what shall we do? Now, I want you to understand that we're starting out talking about the servant and what he saw. The servant saw the circumstances. Can I tell you, there are a lot of people today in the season that you and I are living in right now that are seeing the circumstances, but they're not seeing what God is doing. So we look at this servant, and some of us can say, you know what? I can kind of put myself in there, because this servant, he was looking through the eyes of the flesh. Now, if you were here in this audience today, I would say this, that needs an amen. Because the servant is looking through the eyes of the flesh. The servant sees the problem. It says when he rose early in the morning, he went out, and what did he see? He saw an army that was surrounding the city with horses and chariots. Now listen, that is the physical reality of the situation. Here's the good part. It was not the final reality. But here's what the servant did. He got up early that morning. He walked out. And when he walked out, he looked around the city there. And all he saw was the enemy. He saw the circumstances. He saw the reality. The reality was this. There was an army that had come in the nighttime and surrounded the city where him and the prophet was. And he saw the reality of that. But you and I have to understand this. When we're talking about walking by faith and not by sight, listen, faith does not deny what's going on. A faith life is not a life of denial. It's a life that says there's something bigger than what I see. So all of a sudden, when I begin to look at this, I begin to think what he sees, an army surrounding. He sees the reality, but he doesn't see what the prophet's going to see. And sometimes we get so caught up with the circumstances of what we can see that we miss to see what God wants us to see. In fact, the Bible tells us this. If we can see it, it is temporary. If we can't see it with our natural eyes, it is eternal. So I begin to look at this story and maybe in a little bit different view than what I had prior to, because I look at this and I'm thinking, the servant is looking at the army that is real, but he's looking at something that is very temporary. He's not looking at something that is eternal. The servant of God, the man who's working with the prophet, he believes the odds by the size of the problem. Now stay with me here. He believes the odds by the size of the problem. I don't know if you can imagine this with me or not, but can you imagine getting up one morning and having your coffee and you walk out on your front porch, and when you walk out on the front porch, you look and there is a physical reality of an enemy that has totally surrounded your home. And you know that the enemy has come for one reason, and that is to destroy you. It's not a dream. It's not a vision. It is a reality that enemy is there to destroy you. So I look at this, and I begin to understand. He's looking at the size of the problem. It didn't say that he sent a few, but he sent a great army, and it surrounded him. Listen, we've got people today that feel like they are surrounded by the problem. Whether it's physical, whether it's spiritual, whether it's financial, whether it's a relationship, it doesn't matter. They feel like they are consumed, that they are surrounded by, and they begin to look at the odds of them winning by the size of the problem. See, the truth is this. There was an army in town, and the army had surrounded. The truth is this. There was horses and there was chariots surrounding that city. That's the truth. And what you and I got to understand about faith is this: admitting that the challenge is not denying or living in the lack of faith. Listen, you and I can admit that there's a problem going on. You and I are living in a season right now where there is a problem. There is a problem. And if you listen to the right newscast or really the wrong newscast, all of a sudden that problem begins to consume us. And we don't even look at the healing power of God. We don't even look at the hand of God that could move the situation. We get so caught up in the circle, like the servant. We look at this and we begin to get so caught up in it. See, faith is not denying the challenges. Listen, you and I are living in some challenging times. The praise team gets up here every week and they sing to an empty sanctuary trying to lead people in worship. I get up and preach to an empty sanctuary. And listen, can I tell you, that's challenging. Faith does not deny the challenges there, but it says this: there may be an empty sanctuary to the natural eye, but can I tell you, this sanctuary is by no means an empty sanctuary. That there is the presence of a holy God that never leaves this sanctuary, that's here in this sanctuary. So what you and I say is this: I may not be able to see the people that are sitting in the pew, but I know that there is a God who is filling the house with his presence and his power, and he wants to do an incredible work. So you and I begin to look at this, and we say, you know what? Faith is the ability to acknowledge the problem, but also to see beyond the problem. Faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen, written in the book of Hebrews, chapter 11, verse 1. The servant, this is what happens. He's looking at the circumstances. So when he begins to look at the circumstances, what happens is he gives in. And he's seized by fear. Now, I can just say this, that if I was standing on the front porch and I looked out and I saw horses and chariots and men of war that were surrounding me, can I tell you, I believe we would have an incredible opportunity to let fear grip our hearts. The season that we're going through with this virus, can I tell you, it has gripped people's hearts. And they don't see what God can do. They're gripped by the fear of what the virus can do. I'm not denying that the virus is real. I'm not denying that the virus has taken people's lives. I'm not denying that. But can I tell you, I still believe in a God who can heal when people says that he can't heal. I believe that he's bigger than this virus. I believe that. Now, I don't think that faith calls us to be stupid. I believe faith causes us to see past what we see with our natural, and we begin to look into. So when I look at this servant, I begin to understand. He looks and he's just seized by the fear, because all of these men, warriors that are around him, and they're ready to fight, they're ready to take him out. See, failing to use our faith, sometimes life is overwhelming. If you've got nothing to put your faith in and you don't have a faith in God, I'll just be real honest. I don't know how you live day by day. I don't know how you face the circumstances that happen on just a day-by-day life. I don't know how you face them without having a hope. Can I tell you, in the last year and few months, I have faced some of the biggest battles of my life physically. And if I didn't have a hope that I hoped in Jesus, that he was my healer, that he was my protector, he was never going to leave me, he was never going to forsake me, I don't know what I would do. But can I tell you, the odds were always in my favor when God was in my corner. And can I tell you, I never believed that he ever left my corner. I believe he was always there with me. But you look at this servant and he's seized by fear. And can I tell you, when fear grips us, we do what the servant did. Listen to what he said. My master, what should we do? What should we do? I don't think he said it with confidence. I think he said it with a very shaky voice. I think the words that you can read and you can see, and I believe the words that he's saying, you can hear defeat in them. I don't believe he said it with circumstance. I don't believe he said, what are we going to do? How are we going to win? He said, what are we going to do? We're outnumbered. I mean, look at the circumstances. You've got all this army around you. What are we going to do? I believe he was defeated before the battle ever took place. And see, I believe a lot of us are defeated before the battle ever takes place, because the enemy gets in our head and he begins to tell us how big he is. He begins to tell us what his record is. He begins to tell us others just like we were and how he took them out. And all of a sudden, fear grips us. And before we ever get in the battle, all of a sudden, we're defeated. I can almost see him looking at the prophet and saying, Master, what are we going to do? I can see worry. I can see concern. I can see the defeat. I can see the discouragement on his face. I heard a story about a pastor, and he had cut his arm pretty bad. This has been several years ago. He cut his arm really bad, and he had to go to the hospital and had to get it taken care of. And he got it taken care of, and he didn't have any medical insurance. And when all the bills come in, he owed some $20,000. And all of a sudden, he saw that $20,000. Now, this has been years ago. He saw that $20,000 being so massive. All of a sudden, this is what he began to believe. My ministry's over with. I'm never going to dig out of this hole. I don't know what to do now. And he was discouraged and he was defeated. He had never done anything except got a bill. And thank God for praying mamas. His mama called him on the phone and began to talk to him, and she heard the tears, and she heard the defeat in his voice as he began to talk to his mama and began to tell her about what was going on. And while she listened to her son, then at the moment, then she said this to him. She said, you haven't even given God an opportunity to help you. And the preacher said, you're right. And he went and he prayed and he turned the things over to God. And here's the end of the story. Not $1 come out of his pocket. And the bill at the hospital was completely paid. And I wonder sometimes, I wonder if we're only even giving God an opportunity to get in the middle of our battles. Because we see those battles and they seem so big and so mammoth, and we think, oh, what can happen? And what are we going to do because this is so big? And how big is our God? I mean, how big is our God? And when we begin to look at this, we begin to understand God is great and he is mighty, and there is not anything that he can't do. So you and I shouldn't get overwhelmed at the things that we're dealing with. Well, to stand our ground and say, this is the Word of God. I know what the devil is doing. He's trying to scheme it out. But see if he can get us afraid. If he can get us afraid. I really believe that one of the very tactics of this season that you and I are living in is fear. And I don't know about you, but there's been times I've been afraid. There's been times I've been really afraid. And can I tell you, every time that I've been really afraid, I didn't think right, and I didn't react right. Every time. I remember when I was 17 years old and I was having knee surgery. I had busted my knee up playing football in high school. And I remember when the surgeon, and I remember the orthopedic surgeon, he was one of the top surgeons in this region. And I remember him telling me, he said, "Son," he said, "this is a serious surgery." He said, "You may never walk right again. Your leg may be stiff. It may be shorter than the other one. You may have a limp." And I can tell you, as a 17-year-old not serving God, I was absolutely petrified. All I could think of was, how am I going to come out of this surgery? How am I going to walk after this surgery? Am I going to limp? Is my leg going to be stiff? But thank God for a praying grandma that had a praying preacher that began to pray for a backslidden boy in a hospital room. Told me 2 weeks I would be in the hospital, go through therapy, learn how to walk all over again, if I could ever learn to walk right again. And can I tell you, I come out on the third day, come out of the hospital on a pair of crutches, never had one day of physical therapy. Can I tell you, I know now that the praying grandma and the praying preacher, he prayed and he got a hold of God, and God touched this little boy while I was laying in the hospital bed, and God did an awesome work in my life. Can I tell you, I've got to come to the place that I've got to quit looking at the circumstances and I got to start looking at God. So let's go to the next point. The solution Elijah saw. Let's look at verse 16 through 18. The Bible said, "So he answered, 'Do not fear, for those who are with us are more than those who are with them.'" Now, isn't that a crazy thing to say? There's only two of them. And the Bible said that they are surrounded, but the man of God said, "Don't fear, for those who are with us are more than those who are with them." And Elijah prayed and said, "Lord, I pray, open his eyes that he may see." Then the Lord opened the eyes of the young man, the servant, and he saw. And behold, the mountain was full of horses and chariots of fire all around Elijah. So when the Syrians came down to him, Elijah prayed to the Lord. And he said, "Strike this people, I pray, with blindness." And he struck them with blindness according to the word of Elijah. Elijah challenged fear. Listen, he had the same opportunity to be afraid because he was looking at the same circumstances that the servant was looking at. So what is the difference? What is it? One of them is operating in faith and the other is operating in fear. The man of God, Elijah, he refused to let fear grip him because he understood how big and how awesome his God was. And it's just the opposite for the servant of God. He was afraid and he started counting the people in the army. See, the words and the actions of the servant showed that he was afraid and discouraged and ready to give up. But the words of the prophet of God, it was filled with confidence. I don't know about you, but when I read the Bible, I like to try to visualize. I can visualize Elijah, the man of God, when he come out. I can see him look at this young servant and said, "Son, there is more for us than against us." And I can see the servant, he's looking out and he's thinking, "I don't see nobody. All I see is me and you, and all I see is a large army out here. I don't see them." Human standard. It's a fearful thing to be surrounded by your enemy. Just humanly, it's a fearful thing to be surrounded by your enemy. But here's the thing that we got to do. We cannot let fear wrap its icy tentacles around our heart. Because then we get paralyzed. See, I understand that the church is closed now to people coming in. I get that. But even though the church is closed, the gospel's not closed. Paul said this when he was in prison. He said, "You got me, in chains, but you can't chain the gospel. You can't chain it down. You can chain me down, but you can't change the gospel. It's going out. And can I tell you, right now, the gospel is being preached to more people, has an opportunity to hear than they've ever had. Now, we don't like it the way it is right now, but can I tell you, we may not like it, but more people are having an opportunity to hear the gospel than they've ever had. Because every church now is doing online. Every church is doing a live service now. So the gospel is being preached. What used to be on Facebook was a lot of negativity, and there's still a lot of negativity. But can I tell you, on Facebook now, there's a lot of gospel going out. There's a lot of preaching going out. There's a lot of telling people that Jesus is the only way. So when I begin to look at this, yeah, I don't like it, but I can't be gripped by fear. What Elijah did, he spoke to the fear in the servant. Now watch this. Not only does the prophet stay calm, listen, the world is looking at the child of God. And if you and I are fearful and afraid and operating in fear and not faith, you know what the world says? That God ain't any good. He's not any better than my God. And my God is the world. So when I begin to look at that, I begin to think, wait a minute. Elijah, he stayed calm. But in that calmness, what he did, he instilled the calmness in his servant. Now, and I told you, when I was 17 in the hospital, I was very afraid. I asked everybody to get out of the room except my dad. I wanted everybody out of the room. I was absolutely terrified. I was so afraid. I'd never had surgery. I'd never been put to sleep that I could ever remember, and I was absolutely afraid. And my dad was a businessman. My dad didn't know medicine. He didn't know anything about medicine. He was a businessman. But I said, Dad, will you stay here with me? And can I tell you, the calmness of my dad standing beside my bed, and I knew then, my dad don't know nothing about medicine. My dad don't know anything about an operation. But there was something about my dad being calm that calmed me down. And can I tell you, the world is looking at the church right now. You may not realize it. You may not even understand it. But I can tell you, the world is looking at the church. And can I tell you, the sad part is this. Most church people are more worried and more fearful than the world is. So we've got to come to that place to understand. We need to simply let them know, don't be afraid. Not being harsh, but with that compassion of a loving God. Don't be afraid. I don't even remember if my dad even said anything to me standing by my bed. But his presence by my bed calmed me down. And sometimes all we need is someone to bring the peace of God into the room. Sometimes all we need is somebody just to come in and say, don't be afraid. Listen, don't be afraid of the roar of the lion. Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid of the schemes of the enemy. Don't be afraid, because God already had an answer before the enemy created a problem. Now I want you to hear me. God already had an answer before the enemy created the problem. We serve an awesome God. Elijah, he gave voice to the spiritual realities. Listen what happened. Elijah does something else. He testifies. Son, there's more for us than against us. He's testifying. There's more for us than against us. You have nothing to be afraid of. May have said something like this. It's not by might nor by power, but it's by my spirit, says the Lord. Can I tell you, sometimes we just need to testify. Listen, our testimony service in most churches, we don't have them anymore because they really wasn't testifying anymore. They become a very fear-filled, negative expression that should have never happened. It should be faith. So we need to testify. Listen, the odds are always in our favor when God's in our corner. So when somebody tells you, listen, you don't understand, preacher. You don't understand, teacher. You don't understand, friend. I am surrounded by my enemy, and I don't know what to do. You need to tell them, let me tell you about the time that God brought me out. Come on, there ought to be a time that you and I stand up and say, let me tell you about the time that I didn't have enough money to pay my bills, but my bills got paid. Let me tell you about the time that my marriage was on the rocks, but now years later, we love each other more than we ever have, and we're happier than we've ever been. Let me tell you about the time that I was so sick that I thought I was going to die, and God came in and brought healing into my life. See, the enemy, he's filling the hearts with fear. And God is saying, I'm looking for somebody. I'm looking for a man or a woman of God who will fill those hearts with hope. Listen, we walk around in fear. We do nothing. And God is saying, I need somebody to walk around and give some people hope. I'm here to tell you, I don't believe that our best days as a church is behind us. I think the greatest moves of God, that God is going to move before he raptures the church out, I believe is ahead of us. I believe that. That's why there's hope still in me. I get frustrated about the way things are, but I know that there is a greater hope. If we endure this, we're going to come out of this thing better than we went into it. I remember reading about a cartoon, and it had a cartoon picture, and it had two men who were standing there with swords, and they were surrounded by horses and men on horses, and all of the men on the horses had their swords drawn. And the caption was the two men in the middle, and this is what they said. One of them looked at the other, and he said, we've got them right where we want them. See, can I tell you, you and I ought to have hope in our life. The enemy may be breathing down your neck, but listen, we can say this, greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. He said, when you've done all, stand. Let me just add a little bit more to this. When you've done all, stand and testify about the good things of God. You need to stand and say, I can do all things through Christ Jesus who strengthens me. And we begin to testify about the good things of God. Elijah looked through the eyes of faith. He saw the army of God. Man, I don't know about you, but his eyes were open, and he saw them hills being filled up. He saw the gathering of the horses and the chariots of fire. He started looking through the eyes of faith and not the eyes of flesh. Elijah saw more than what he saw with his natural eyes. He saw more. Elijah, sure, he saw the army, the Syrian army. He saw them, but when he began to look out and when he began to look by faith, he began to see what was beyond that. See, if you look and you see that you're outnumbered, you need to look again. If you look and it looks like everything is bad, you need to look again. If you look out and the enemy has surrounded you, you need to look again. Let me say this, and I want you to hear me. God is on your side. God is for you. The odds are always in your favor when God's in your corner. Now watch what the prophet did. He prayed that the servant would see what he saw. I don't know about you, but I'd like to see what he saw. I would like to stand in this pulpit one Sunday and begin to look out and begin to see all the angels and all the warring angels that are filling this sanctuary. Sometimes people around us are falling apart and they're retreating from the battle. Sometimes the people that you and I have served with and worked with, they will tuck tail and they will run from the battle when it gets hot. But you and I have got to stand our ground and simply pray. Just pray. Don't let fear become contagious. And I listen, they talk about this COVID-19 and it being contagious and the flu being contagious. Can I tell you, I believe what is as worse, if not more worse, is when fear becomes contagious. And people start getting, and because see, when you're afraid, you lose hope. We need to have hope. God is able. So we begin to understand. So what you and I've got to do, we got to become the sane voice. Now hear me, we got to become the sane voice of faith when it faces a battle. Listen, don't judge Don't judge them. Don't criticize them. Don't belittle them. Don't think more highly of yourself than they. Don't think you're all of this because you've got faith and they don't. Don't do that. Instead, we begin to pray for them that they can see what we see, that they can experience what we've experienced, that we realize that the battle is not mine, but the battle is the Lord's. And the prophet of God, he stood safe in the protective hedge of God's presence. Elijah refused to run. And can I tell you, we as Christians, as Christ followers, we need to refuse to run. Elijah stood strong in the power of the Lord. I've seen, and in fact, I have given altar calls when you knew God was moving, and yet no one in the building was moving. It was tight. Nobody moved. Sit there. And all of a sudden, maybe when they're singing "Just As I Am," one person steps out in an aisle and starts walking down to the altar. And then all of a sudden, others begin to pop up, and they begin to walk down. It just took one person stepping out by faith to move more people to step out by faith and begin to move. But here, on the flip side of that, I have read about the war stories of wars that we have fought in America, and I've read stories about them that when they would get into a battle and all of a sudden maybe the victory was in limbo there, who was going to win, and all of a sudden one person would break rank and take off. And then the whole battalion would take off, and they would run from the battle because of one person. And I begin to think, what kind of person am I? And that's the thing you ought to think of. What kind of person are you? Do you walk by faith, or do you run from the battles? Do you stand your ground, or do you run from the battles? And this is what the prophet of God did. And I'm going to try to wrap this up pretty quick. He prayed. Listen, he prayed. He not only gave a voice to his faith, but he prayed. And can I tell you, prayer is always in order. But listen to what he prayed for. He prayed that his servant would see what he saw. And then he prayed that his enemy would be blinded. See, there's sometimes that when you and I pray, we need to pray, God, blind our enemies that they can't find us, that they don't know where we are. We need to begin to pray, because when we pray, what happens is this: it rallies the resources of heaven to become on our behalf. So when Elijah began to pray, all of a sudden heaven began to move. Angels were dispatched. Armies were dispatched. And all of a sudden, we see this great host that's surrounding. Son, there's more for us than against us. See, when he prayed, all of a sudden, things began to happen. When he began to look out of the eyes of faith, something began to happen. Let me read this, verses 19 and 20. And it said, now Elijah said, this is not the way, nor is this the city. Follow me, and I will bring you to the man whom you seek. But he led them to Samaria. So it was when they had come to Samaria that Elijah said, Lord, open the eyes of these men. Remember, he prayed for them to be blinded. They couldn't see. He said, open the eyes, and they saw. And the Lord opened their eyes, they saw, and they were inside Samaria. God answered the prayer, and he blinded the enemy. Elijah led them into the stronghold of Israel, the Syrian army, who used to be the surrounders. Now we're surrounded. So we need to ask God, open up our eyes. God reveals the situation. There's a song that we sing, and it's talking about that he'll turn a situation around. Can I tell you, we need some turnaround in our situation. We need to quit fussing about it. We need to quit being afraid about it. And we need to say, God, I'm calling upon you to turn my situation around. I need to turn around in my life. I need to turn around in my health. I need to turn around in my finances. I need to turn around in my marriage. I need to turn around in my walk with you. God, I need a turnaround. And all of a sudden, we realize that God will give us a turnaround. In fact, Isaiah said this, when the enemy comes in like a flood, the Spirit of God will raise up a standard against him. The odds are always in your favor. Odds are always in your favor when God is with you. So listen to this. God is in your corner. God is one of your biggest fans. He's one of your biggest cheerleaders. He's cheering you on. He's wanting you to win. He's not waiting for you to fail. He don't want to watch you fail. He wants to cheer you on. And can I tell you, I believe that God and the host of angels are cheering the church on. I believe they're saying, don't be afraid. Stand your ground. Fight your battle. God is going to do some incredible things. See, now, hear me this. The odds at one moment in this story seem like they were in favor of the enemy. But that's not the end of the story, because God did a turnaround. When they looked like they were in favor of the enemy, God turned it around. And now at the end of this story, the favor is in Elijah and the servant. Don't lose hope. Don't lose hope. God has got some great things for you. In fact, God will turn your situation around. And we've got incredible examples all through the Bible of where God turned a situation around. And let me give you just a few. Joseph, Moses, Joshua, David, Daniel, Peter, Paul, me and you. And he wants us to testify. See, the odds may look against us. How are we going to pay our bills? I've been given bad news by the doctor. My spouse says it's over. What do I do? When you see the mountains and they're full of your enemy, could I just say this? Don't be afraid. God is for you. And if God is for you, who can be against you? Don't be afraid. The odds are in your favor when God's in your corner. And if you're a child of God, can I tell you, He is in your corner. He is cheering you on. He is cheering you toward victory. He has given you every opportunity to live a victorious life in Christ. I can just imagine, I can close my eyes and I can imagine that when you and I pray and we say, God, I'm struggling. God, I feel like I'm surrounded by my circumstance, by my situation. I can almost hear God say, ask me, just ask me and I'll show up on the scene. And I'll send armies and I'll send angels and I'll show up and we'll defeat your enemy. Because see, the odds are always in my favor when God's in my corner. And the odds are in your favor when God's in your corner. And you may be going through a situation. You may have stumbled across this message today. You say, I don't even know why I stopped. I'll tell you why you stopped. You're looking for a God who can do a turnaround in your life. And I believe God is wanting to do a turnaround in your life, and He's wanting to do a turnaround in my life. He's wanting to do a turnaround in the churches. And He's wanting to change the situation. It may appear in your life right now that the enemy's got the upper hand. But I want you to hear me. That's not the end of the story. If you pray and if you call on God, God will turn your situation around and you'll come out victorious on this. You may need to turn around in your life physically. You may need to turn around in your life financially. You may need to turn around in a relationship. You may need to turn around in your family with your children. You may need to turn around spiritually. You may sit here today and you say, I remember when I was younger. I remember when my mom and dad took me to church. And I remember those stories. I remember how God turned situations around. But you find yourself today, you find yourself not serving God. Can I tell you, it's not too late. The end of your story has not been written yet. God wants to change your circumstance around. I'm going to ask again, I want to ask the praise team just to pray as we ask you today. If you were sitting in this congregation today, what I would ask you is this. I would probably say, bow your head and close your eyes, and I would give an altar call, and I would say, if you're not right with God, you need to make it to an altar. You may be waiting for somebody else to make a move before you'll make a move. Can I tell you, don't wait for someone else to make the move. You be the man or woman of faith and you make the move. You may be sitting there with your family. Why don't you just slip off that couch or out of that chair and fall down on your knees and Why don't you call out on this God that we serve and say, God, I'm not living for you like I should, and I know that I'm not. And I want you to come and forgive me of my sins and wipe all of my sins away. And I want to be your child. I want you to come and live in my heart, and I want you to guide my steps every day, and I want to serve you all the days of my life. I want to walk by faith and not in fear. And then I'm going to tell you, in just a moment's time, you'll go from a sinner to a saint. Your name will be inscribed in the Lamb's Book of Life, and He will call you His child. Now, the thing you need to do is this. If you've made a decision for Christ, you need to let somebody know. You need to let somebody know, I've made a decision. He said, if you're ashamed of me, I'll be ashamed of you. Don't be ashamed of making the decision. Let somebody know. And we would love to know. Make a comment, I've accepted Christ. Send a private message, you've accepted Christ. Now I want to pray for those that need a turnaround in their physical or in their finance or in their relationship, because God is a God of turnarounds, and He'll turn your situation around if you'll ask Him. Elijah, the man of God, prayed, and when he prayed, God turned it. We're going to pray for you now. Father, in the name of Jesus, God, we pray for those who may be watching. God, they need a touch in their body. We know, God, some of our own Abundant Life family today, God, before this service started, we had prayer for them. And God, again, I pray for them, and I lift them up to you, and I ask you to touch them. I pray, God, for those that are watching today that need that touch physically, need that touch in their finances. God, they got bills. They don't know how they're going to pay them. They're wondering what's going to happen. I've lost my job because of this. And fear is trying to grip them. God, I pray that right now faith would rise up within them and they would see you bigger than their problem. God, in relationships, we pray for peace. We pray for restoration. God, for moms and dads with their sons and their daughters. We pray for families. God, this season has caused a lot of heartache between families, and I pray for them today, God. I pray there be restoration in them. God, I pray turn situations around. Turn them around, God. God, that we walk by faith and not by fear. And God, we ask it and we believe it in that wonderful, strong, and mighty name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Thank you.